Amen. Well, welcome on this wonderful Sunday morning. If you could sign the attendance pads and pass them down, that would be great. If you could draw a line between the 9 o'clock service, 11, and write 11 at that for the first person signing, that's helpful for the person who puts it in. They don't have to guess which service you go to without ever having seen you. Our prayer focus this week is, I don't know if you've seen the news about the earthquake in Morocco and the floods in Libya. A lot of devastation, a lot of loss of life. I think in the floods in Libya, they're estimating 10,000 lives have been lost in that. The pictures out of Morocco are just heartbreaking. So that is going to be our prayer focus this week. So please keep them in your prayers. On October 21st, we're going to have a work day around here and a time of fellowship. We'll have more information coming to that. But we're going to start at 7 with a breakfast. And so we would need to know if you want to come to that fellowship and then come out and do things around the church, getting it look nice, same for our trunk or treat. So just call the office if you want to come to that, but there'll be a sign-up sheet in the back in the coming weeks. Or you can call Mark Seamer or Mark Lambert, and they'll give you more information on what we're going to be doing around here to kind of do some work. Also, next week, if you're interested in joining the church, we have our coffee with the pastor right before this service, about 10:15, we meet over there in my office. But if you just gather around by the door there that says church office, I'll find you, and then we can go back to my office. Then we'll talk about what it means to be a member, what the church is like. So if you're interested in that, just be over there. And next Sunday, we're going to have a pool party at the Parsonage from noon to 3. At noon, we're inviting all our little kids to come for them to have a chance to swim. And there'll be some lunch there. And then at 1 o'clock, the youth are going to come, and the kids can decide whether they want to hang around with the big kids or want to go on, or if they just want to sit there and eat. They can do that too, but that'll be next Sunday. A lot of fun. Our pumpkins are arriving on October 14th, which is a Saturday afternoon. We need lots of help getting the pumpkins off the truck. And then after we get the pumpkins off the truck, we need help selling the pumpkins to get them off the property. So that's equally important to getting them off the truck. So we always rely on a lot of y'all to come and to help sell those things. And it's a way to meet the community and have fellowship. So there'll be sign-up sheets for that coming soon. And October 25th is our trunk or treat from 6 to 8. If you'd like to donate candy, we always need candy because a lot of kids come by. Some people run out. But we also need people who are willing to decorate their cars. And you don't have to be spectacularly decorated. You've got to... Some people go all out. Some people like me go half out. I'm trying to identify with those who are not putting a lot of effort in there to say, you beat the pastor. But it's just a lot of fun. Now, they're like 300 to 500 kids come here. It's a lot of time that parents come that. So a lot of excitement there. And Bill Burley would like to come forward and speak something about Emmaus. There he is.
Good morning. My name is Bill Burley, and I'd like to invite everyone to a potluck dinner at the church COC next Saturday night at 5:30. Hopefully you saw one of these brochures on the way in when you picked up your bulletin. How many of you have heard of the Emmaus Walk, or maybe a Cursillo or Tres Dias or New Beginnings? Thank you. And how many of you have attended one of these walks? If you would please stand. Thank you so much for standing up. When we were young or at some point in our life, we decided, made that decision to give our life to Christ. And we enjoyed that moment. We asked Christ to come into our life, and he's been with us ever since. When we left the area where we gave our life to Christ, we got into the world. We got into school. We got into work. We got into friends. We got into neighbors. We got into hobbies. We got into so much. Not that we have lost our faith or don't have as strong a faith as we did when we first committed, but the Emmaus Walk and any of these other three walks by different religions are a way to increase and maintain that spark of love and grace that Christ gives all of us. And I'd like to invite everybody to come to the potluck dinner. We're going to answer questions about the Emmaus Walk. Some people I've talked to think that it's sort of just a select few or it's secretive. It's not at all. Nothing about loving Christ is secretive. We all know that. A few weeks ago, Pastor Harry gave a wonderful sermon on the word ask. And what really stuck out to me was a statistic that he cited. Among Methodist churches, 85% of the people that attend were simply asked to come. So I'm asking everybody to come and find out about the Emmaus Walk, what it is, and how it may help you increase your relationship with Christ. Thank you.
And one of the common questions I get is, how long do you have to walk? And you don't. It's based on the scripture where the two disciples walked to Emmaus, is why we call it a walk to Emmaus. You do more sitting than anything and eating. You don't want to fast when you're going to walk to Emmaus. And at this time, I want to invite Svetlana Johnson to come forward. Svetlana's been with us for longer than I've been here. It's just her work schedule, and Dr. Joe married her and Bill, but because of her schedule, she never got the opportunity to officially join, and so we're going to do that officially today. So Svetlana, I just ask you, will you be loyal to this congregation, the United Methodist Church, and support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? And with that, then we extend the right hand of Christian fellowship and welcome you, and ask all of you all to welcome her. You can clap. And at this time, then, let us prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, let us stand for our call to worship.
The Lord is our strength and our song.
The Lord is our salvation.
O God, you lead the people you have redeemed.
The Lord will reign forever and ever.
And please continue standing while we sing together our gathering hymn number 380, There's Within My Heart a Melody.
Whisper sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Today we'll be reciting the Nicene Creed. Please repeat after me. Oh, actually, speak with me. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven
and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy and apostolic church. We acknowledge baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Bye.
be seated. We now come to that time where we lift up our prayer requests and our praises. Any praises this morning? But we will pray that you get healing and health. Something with your feet, Marty. Your last time you... huh? Same foot. Oh. Well, we're glad you had a good trip otherwise. That's a long trip, but other praises. Yes. So if a friend was just transferred from a facility in St. Cloud and she's doing good and she's 82, well, we praise God that she's doing good and we pray for her to continue that way. Other praises. It's good to see that number of people in the choir, isn't it? I think more of this week than last week. And y'all can join them.
I see some of you singing out there.
Don't be shy. Prayer requests. Any prayer requests this day? Well, it's good everybody's doing okay. We got one back here. Yes. Fourth stage throat cancer. We'll keep him in our prayers. That's too young. Yes.
I'd just like to send out a prayer card. A prayer for our deputy mayor that passed away.
Yes, we'll keep him in our prayers, the family in our prayers. And Marjorie says her daughter's doing good after the tumor's been removed. She's healing up fine. It was not cancerous or malign or anything, but it was a big tumor. They think it had been growing for about 30 years. It just, until it shows up and causes problems. But she's doing good, and we continue to pray for her. But let us go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, as we come here this morning, we are so grateful for your love. We are so grateful for all the blessings you give us, the purpose you give us, the hope you give us. Lord, you bless us so much, we can't even count all of it. But we thank you for all you bless us with this day. And Lord, as we come here this day, knowing that we are living in a blessed time, in a blessed place, there are others that are dealing with tragedies. There are parts of Florida that are still recovering from hurricanes, not only this year, but last year. So Lord, be with those that are helping them to rebuild their lives. We also look at the images from Morocco and Libya. And Lord, the loss of life is tragic. But we know that you are at work there. And we thank you for our United Methodist Committee on Relief that is working with agencies there. And we just ask that you bless that partnership. Bless them as they go in and they help people in your name. And Lord, we lift up all of those who are not only in these incidents, but everywhere of helping their neighbor to recover. We ask your blessings upon them. And Lord, here in our church, help us to be a good neighbor, to always be on the lookout for those that are hurting, that could use a hand, that could use a good word, that could use an aid. Don't harden our hearts, Lord, but show us how we can serve. And Lord, we also lift up those that are on our prayer list this morning. You know their needs. And Lord, we lift them up to you, knowing that you can restore them. We lift up the prayer requests that we have named before you just a few moments ago. We even now, Lord, lift up to you that one name, that one request that is silent in our heart that we name before you now. And gracious Heavenly Father, we do lift up our congregation to you. We thank you for the purposes you give us, the plans you have for us. And Lord, in the coming month, we'll be preparing for our annual charge conference, and we're filling new positions with new people. And Lord, I just ask that you people in our congregation, that you open their eyes and minds to the work we have to have done, so that we can fill our positions and that this church can have everything it needs to move forward, to do your willing, to do your calling on us. So Lord, touch our lives and show us our calling both individually and collectively, so that we can be your church shining your light into this into this community and beyond. Help us to touch those lives that are hurting. And we thank you that you give us the ability. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who makes all of this possible, who gives us the strength, the power, and the wisdom to go and to do, who through the Holy Spirit empowers us to be. We thank you for these good gifts, and we thank you for the precious gift of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray the prayer we now pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we invite our children to head off to Children's Church. They'll go through the double doors over there to the room right on the right, and then they'll return at the end of the service. And we'll continue singing.
Let's continue with hymn number 340. 340, Come Ye Sinners, Poor and Needy.
To hear
We come now where we lift up our tithes and offerings. And in response to the earthquake in Morocco and the floods in Libya, the United Methodist Committee on Relief has been working with local agencies there, and I've got some information that came in that how we can help them contribute to that effort that's going on there. So we'll be taking up an offering today or next week if you want to bring it in. For that, you can just write on your check, UMCOR, or if you go onto the app, it should be one of the pull-downs, UMCOR there, and we will get that to UMCOR, who, as I said, they're working with local agencies in both those locations to bring relief, and so if that is where God is leading you, I thank you for that. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Grace Heavenly Father, once again, we come before you thankful of the many blessings you give us, the love you give us, the forgiveness and grace you surround us with. Oh Lord, you are more ready to bless than we are to receive. We don't even recognize all the blessings, but you continue to love. You continue to help us to grow. You continue to smooth our walk, and we thank you for all this. And so Lord, now as we come and return a portion of that blessing back to you in the form of these, our tithes and offerings, Lord, use them to help others, to bless others. Guide us in their use, Lord, and multiply them for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 14th chapter, beginning the first verse. Hear now these words. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to the Lord. While those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. Let us therefore no longer pass judgment on one another, but resolve instead never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of another. I know and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it is unclean. If your brother or sister is being injured by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. Do not let what you eat cause the ruin of one for whom Christ died. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, in my many years now of serving in churches before I went into ministry and as a pastor, I've noticed that one of the most problematic things churches and Christians do is to get caught up in the weeds of things. We argue about absolutely anything and nothing. We make stands on some of the smallest things in life. And these become problems. We forget why we are gathered together, that it is about Christ and our learning to be true disciples. Tom Rainer's done a lot of research and he's done a lot of helping with churches. And he noted some issues that had come up in various churches as he's met with them. And he wrote down some of these things that were issues in churches, some even causing splits in churches. And some of these things that our churches have argued out and even split over are things like one church argued over the appropriate length of the worship pastor's beard. That was a concern within the congregation to the point that it was about to divide the church. Another church, a deacon accused another deacon of sending an anonymous letter, and he said, "Let's settle this in the parking lot." We find that in the Bible everywhere. And one church argued and had a contentious vote to decide if a clock in the worship center should be removed. We have one here. I don't know if you know. You can't see it, but I can see it. Because that's how most churches are. They put the clock where the pastor can see it, but not the people. One church had a 45-minute heated argument over what type of filing cabinet to buy. Should it be black or brown? Another church, it's a huge church with a big budget, had a long meeting arguing over the church budget was 10 cents off. Now, this is something treasurers worry about, but not the rest of us. And a business meeting arguments in one church were about whether the church should buy a weed eater or not, and they spent two business meetings to make up their mind whether to buy a weed eater or not. We get involved in the weeds. Another church argued over what type of green beans the church should serve in the church. And two churches reported fights over the type of coffee to serve. In one of the churches, they moved from Folgers to the stronger Starbucks brand. And in another church, they simply went with a stronger blend, and members left the church because the coffee was stronger. And it was free still, but it was... In one church, there was a major conflict when the youth borrowed a crock pot out of the kitchen that hadn't been used in years. They didn't ask for permission. In one church, I love this, had an argument over whether the church should allow deviled eggs at potlucks. In one church, the potlucks had a major discussion or disagreement over the term potluck. It's not luck. It should be called pot blessings. In another church, members left because one church member hid the vacuum cleaner from them. And this resulted in a major fight and a split. And another church had a dispute over whether the church should allow people to wear black t-shirts since black is the color of the devil. So I guess I'm messing up. And then another church had a fight over whether they should sing happy birthday every week to the people who had birthdays that week. We get down in the weeds sometimes and we lose sight of the important things. The first church I ever served was when I was going to seminary. There's a little rural church there in Georgia outside of Atlanta. And before I got there, they had a heated argument over what to do that almost about a piano that almost split the church. And this is after the church had gone through one split over something the pastor did. They went from worshiping 200 down to about 40 people, and then they're about to split again. See, this church, they have two pianos, one in the sanctuary, one in the fellowship hall. When it's time to buy a new piano, they put the new one in the sanctuary because that's where worship is, and they take the one in the sanctuary and move it to the fellowship hall and get rid of the one in the fellowship hall. And they were buying a new one because the one in the fellowship hall couldn't be tuned anymore. It was 60 years old. The problem was the piano in the fellowship hall had been donated in memory of somebody. And the family members thought this was a slight to their family member that the church was getting rid of a piano that served its purpose for 60 years and could no longer be tuned. So they put it in the narthex that had no room. So when I got there, there was a piano in a narthex and they had to tell me the story. We get lost in the weeds. We argue over, as Paul calls them, opinions. See, Paul addressed this issue in several of his letters, and we heard about it again today. And Paul has an interesting way of labeling the two sides. One side he calls the weak, and he uses the term asthenio, which can mean feeble, and it's translated be diseased or impotent man or sick or to be made weak. And then the other side, which Paul always identifies himself with, calls the strong, the dunatos. And it means powerful or capable. It's translated as able, could, mighty person, possible, power, and strong. But what's interesting, while Paul sides with the strong, he uses these things to shame the strong in favor of the weak. And this seemed more clearly in his first letter to the Corinthians, where that subject comes along too. See, in Corinth, they had a problem with whether they should eat meat or not, because in Corinth, the only place you could go to the butcher shops, where the butcher shops were part of the Greek gods' temples. So the meat was always sacrificed to whatever Greek god there is. They butchered it up and then sold it. So some Christians said, oh, we can't eat that. It's been sacrificed to idols, and we'd be honoring idols. Another says, you fool, there's no such thing as a Greek god. There's no idol there, so we can eat whatever we want to eat. And they argued about that. And here again, they're arguing about, do we eat meat or do we only do vegetables? Do we honor one day above the others or do we honor all days equally? He was causing division. And like I said, Paul puts himself in the strong category, but he always sides with the weak. See, for Paul, it wasn't so much the actual action that we did in our everyday lives. It was the motive behind our actions. Was God influencing why we did what we did? If you're doing what you did to honor and glorify God, then great. That's what Paul's saying. So what if it looks a little different and a little weird to somebody else? If you're doing it to honor God, then that's all that needs to be done. But some of us, we get caught up because we want to be right. We want to be right. I don't know anybody here who likes to say, I like to be wrong all the time. And in our faith, sometimes we want to believe we have it all down. And when we see somebody doing it not like us, we think they're wrong and we're right. And we forget that none of us has it all right. All of us are messing up something. All of us are getting something wrong because of the way we've been brought up, the traditions we have. But we have this desire to be right. I remember when I was in Georgia, and a couple came to me and asked me if I could marry them because their church wouldn't marry them. See, they had been living together. And there are pastors who will not marry you if you've been living together. I've never been one of those. I find, like, if you want to make it right, I will help you make it right. But this church, as I was talking to them and understanding the struggles they were having, one of the couples finally said, well, you know, there's about 40 of us, but this church believes they are the only church in the United States that is doing it right, and everybody else is wrong. That's how we get sometimes. We're so arrogant that we think we have it right when we're wrong. As I thought about it, that's what we feel deep down. We all want to be right. And there's something inside us that wants to be right in everything to do, but that's impossible. See, Paul, when he wrote one time, he reminded us that no matter how good or motivated we are, we all fall short of God's glory, and we need God's grace. And if we need God's grace, then we should be willing to give grace to others. And a lot of things that we hold dear to, we really don't understand why we hold them dear. Almost every church has an altar rail in it. It's become a place where you can come and kneel. But do you know why the altar rail started in churches? It had nothing to do with faith. It was because the church was one of the largest buildings in many towns, and it became the marketplace for all the animals Monday through Saturday to be shared. So they had to put up a rail because they always kept the bread and the juice or the wine from the Sunday service communion, and they didn't want the animals to get up there and eat it, so they put a rail up. And we've now made it a holy device. But it had that as its beginnings. See, we don't know sometimes why we do that with communion. You know, we put cloth over that. We come up here and we cover the bread and we cover the juice. We think it's in Scripture that we do that, that it's something holy about it. And we make up reasons why we're doing it, when the sheer fact, the reason we've been doing this all along is because churches used to not have windows. And if you don't have windows and you got food and wine, you got flies. So they covered it to keep the flies, and now we just keep doing it. But we don't do that in our homes. When you serve your meal, you don't put a blanket over there while you're putting it on the table, because you're in a place that's got air conditioning and you don't have flies. Now, when I served communion in Cuba, they didn't have windows. We had to cover the wine up or it'd be full of flies. And companies get caught up in this. How many of you remember aspirin coming with cotton in the top? Just stuffed in there. Well, Bayer in 1999, they finally got around and saying, why are we putting the cotton in there? And they realized they started it in 1914. And that's because in 1914, when they shipped their bottles of aspirin, the roads weren't very good, the trucks didn't have great stability on it, and they shook the heck out of those bottles. And the aspirin, so they started putting cotton in there. They said by the 80s, our shipping was pretty good, the trucks are smoother, we don't shake them that much, why are we putting it in there? Chris Allen, who was the vice president of technology, said, we concluded there was no reason to do it other than tradition. And besides, it's hard to get out. But some people would hold things that are tradition as no, they have to be done. So Paul is trying to help us to understand that there are a lot of things we do in following Christ that differ from person to person, and each one can be right. When we worship, each of us has different elements of the service we particularly like, while others we simply sit through. Before I came here in Gainesville, the new church that I was starting, we only had one service. But we wanted to do praise song and hymns. And so we did what a lot of people would call a blended service. I hate the word blended. I called it an intergenerational service because we had something for each generation. And when we were doing that, when we did praise songs, the older people would sit there like this. I mean, they got their arms high up there so I could see it. And then the younger people, when we would sing a hymn, they're like, oh, God. Because they, again, wanted me to see that, why are we singing? And I started talking to them, and it took 6 months for it to catch in. That there are things we do in service that you don't necessarily get a lot out of. But if in those moments when you're not getting a lot out of it, if you instead of sitting here like this or like this, if you would look around in the service and see, is there somebody else getting something out of it? And if you look at them and you see someone who's just singing to all they can, then you are giving them a gift. A gift of worship. Just like when it's you're doing something and it's your time and this is what we should be doing all the time. There's someone else who's saying, no, it's not mine. And they're giving a gift back to you. And that's what our worship is. It's giving and receiving among each other as we give to God. And when we have differences of opinions and we are tolerant with one another, we are giving and receiving this love. And that's the way we're called to do. Because each of us has different ways that are meaningful to us. And a lot of our faith is truly preference. And that preference stems from our culture we grew up in, the traditions we grew up. If we grew up in one church, we tend to focus on that one church. I grew up in the Army. I have hundreds of churches in my background. And they all did it differently. But sometimes we just want everybody to be like us. And there's a story that's shared about a farmer who makes this point. And he had an orchard there of trees, and he was showing it off to a friend of his. And when he brought him into the friend, when he first went in this orchard, he's just amazed. Look at the trees. They're all in a row this way. And if you look diagonally, they're all in a row that way. It's like going to our national cemeteries. If you've ever been there, the headstones, they all line up. And as they're walking through the trees, all of a sudden there is one ugly, weird tree that isn't out in the right order. It's just stuck out of place. And his friend, he's visiting, he says, you know, if that were my tree, I'd root it up in order to preserve the uniformity of the orchard. And the farmer kind of grinned and laughed and looked down, and he said, well, I know it's a weird-looking tree, but this weird-shaped tree has yielded more fruit than any of the other trees planted in the regular pattern. The farmer's basically saying he was more interested in the fruit than the form. And when God looks at us, he's more interested in our fruit than our form. We sometimes get caught up in the form and not the fruit. See, Jesus did not say, go and make people like you and me. He said, go and make disciples. And each of us has our preferences. And people have come and talked to me, well, do you believe this? Do you believe that? I said, I have my beliefs. But my number one job is to introduce people to Jesus Christ and let him judge them. Because that's who the judge is, not me. I'm still growing and learning. But I love God and I'm trying to introduce as many people as I can, and I've never let anyone's past hold them back. That's what we're to be about. Now, this does not mean that Paul is saying that we should accept anything and everything. We shouldn't, as I could make a suggestion, you know, we need more men in the church, so why don't we go get the Hooters waitresses to come be our ushers? We might get us a few more men in the church, but it would probably have the wrong signal. There are things we don't do. Paul is talking about the many nuances in our faith. Listen to what he says again. He says, one man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord. He who gives thanks to God. For he who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So that whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. That is the main thing that counts. There are things we stand firm on. But when we read Scripture, we can find many things that Scripture is kind of fuzzy on, and we have disagreements on. And I've come to learn over my years that I think Scripture and the Spirit purposely did not spell out, how do you do a baptism? Do you do it at this age, this way, dress this way, in this thing, out that way? Or how do we do communion? Does it look like this? What do we call it? Because I've learned that if we have a specific order, we worship the order and not the purpose of the order. God leaves things vague because he wants us to lead with love and worship him and not all the little stuff. As I said, there are things that we stand firm. For Paul, one of his firm things is you cannot earn your way into heaven. There's a faith and a response to our faith. And there are times he pointed out to the Christians, you are doing it wrong. In 1 Corinthians 5, we read Paul's admonition to the Corinthians because they messed up a lot. He writes, it's actually reported that there is a sexual immorality among you and of a kind that does not even occur among the pagans. A man has his father's wife and you guys are proud of it. He says, there are things that we say no to. But that's a small list. The bigger things that we argue about is meaningless. See, when we look at Scripture, it's about relationships. Relationships among each other and relationship with God. This is why the two commandments of Jesus quieted sum it all up. Love God with all you have and love your neighbors yourself, and everything else stems from that. We lead with love. We lead with acceptance and grace because that is what God has led with us. Everything we do is relational. And so there are things that boost the relationship and there are things that tear down the relation. Paul closes this section by about how to deal with differences by reminding us not to be stumbling blocks, not to put obstacles in the way of people who are growing in their faith. There are many things we disagree with about issues of faith, but the overriding issue is our love for God and our neighbor. Are they the same? John Wesley preached a sermon on the Catholic spirit. And in it, he said, you know, we're all messed up because we've divided up into denominations. If we all had it right, we would be worshiping in one church, but we're not. We just don't know what's wrong. But the way we should lead is my heart with your heart? And if it is, then our differences don't matter. Then we can serve God together. That's what Paul's trying to remind these churches. One of the ways that Paul had did it just a short bit ago before he got to this in his book, Letter to the Romans, he said to all the people not to think so highly of yourself. See, when we think highly of ourselves and we got it all down, that's when we mess up. That's when we fall. When we think humbly of ourselves, that we're still learning, still growing, still becoming, then we can love one another even though we have differences of opinion and we don't have to argue and split over these weedy issues. Let us lead with love, that self-giving love in all we do. For this is what we will be judged with in the end by Christ. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you love us. In spite of our petty arguments, in spite of so many things we do, you love us. And you call us to a higher calling, a higher purpose. You call us to die to self and to be renewed by the renewing of our mind. Lord, help us to grow in your grace. Help us to love one another and have an accepting spirit when we differ in opinions. But let us hold firm to loving one another and loving you with all we have. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we can walk closer with you every day. And in walk closing with you, love you more. We pray this in your Son's most precious holy name. Amen.
Please stand together for our closing hymn, number 528, Nearer My God to Thee.
As we prepare to leave, let us reach up and grab God's hand because he's going to walk with you. And as you leave this place, may our Lord Jesus Christ bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may he give you peace as you live this life. Amen.